laisser la chance. Yeah. Good morning. How you guys doing? Send it my way. Thou hast taught me to know it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well. Good morning, Joyce. Good morning. The let love in Spanish so much. Good morning here from Liberia. It's 9:30 a.m. Good morning. Good morning. Yes, it's almost 10:30 over here. We are 1 hour ahead of you guys. So, what a touching topic. It is a touching one. It is an emotional one. And it is also one for hope. Okay? I'm wearing my glasses because I'm very emotional. But I'm going to try to keep it together because I am hosting the show. I should be able to control myself. So, what do I say? How do I introduce this? It's a sad day for me, but I choose to be happy. I choose to be happy. I choose to be happy because some things we cannot control. I choose to be happy because I have kids. And I never made the choice. But I just want everybody to know that people die. People don't have to be sick sometimes to die. People don't have to have accidents sometimes to die. And if it is not your time to die, nothing will kill you. You can fall from mountain to the ground. If it is not your time to die, you will not die. I know where we come from. It's very diabolical. But I wasn't trained that way. I don't have parents who go to consult oracles. I was born into a Christian home. But sometimes, people just choose their way when they grow up. They choose if they want to follow the parents' footstep or not. This message today, it's difficult, but I'm going to stand my ground today to deliver this message to every widow out there. Everyone that is going through what I'm going through, but still putting a smile on people's face, but still doing anything they could to stay happy as long as they are not hurting anybody. I will encourage you to keep living. To not listen to what people say. Because people are wicked. People are sad. Some people are heartless. People will know that you're going through pains, but they will want to put more pain. They want to add more pains into your pains. Not everybody wants you to be happy in this life. But if you're somebody who's determined, if you're somebody who knows your purpose in this life, you will not let anything that people do or say to hold you back. I have been called names because I lost my husband 3 years ago. Even people who come to my house to eat and drink, they talk nonsense about me behind my back, and some in my face, and some online. But all I have to say is that it is well with my soul. It is well with my children. It is well with us. Because as long as I am not the first young woman or even old woman who had lost a husband, I will not be the first to be accused by shallow Africans of killing a husband. For what? That he was shot? That he was poisoned? Things to other people who had not done them wrong. To people who had not done them wrong, they would bring in all sorts of problems to your life just because you choose to be happy, just because you choose not to live a wayward life, just because they think that now your husband is dead, you're going to join us in the group to live wayward. I reject all of you in the name of Jesus. I rebuke every negative word that has been spoken over my life, over the life of my children, because I have refused to join a negative group and become wayward. I reject them. Because I married for love. I married for better, for worse, till death do us part. It was when I came to Europe that I began to hear from our Nigerian women that they take paper and leave the man. I did not sign that contract. I was traditionally married. My husband paid my bride price. I married in Nigeria, I married in Holland, legally. I have two beautiful kids. What is the problem? That he doesn't give me money? That he's not feeding me? That he's abusing me? There is no relationship that they don't have problems. Every house has a scratch. But I didn't have a home of war. Families have problems. People have issues. But they will want to bring their own issue to put in your home to cause problems for you. Only when you have God that you can know this kind of people. Some of them are your friends. 2 months before my husband died, I traveled to Africa. Because I came to Holland. The first week I relocated to Holland, I got pregnant with my first child. They were even saying, oh, maybe carry pikin from Africa come. My family in-law could not wait to come to the hospital to see the child, if it was really my husband's child. Because it's like, you just come, you just get belly. How you understand? People, of course. But the God that we serve is always the God I'm going to serve. It will never change. You understand? So my first child was born. Carbon copy of his father. Everybody happy. I'm not a wayward woman. I am not a woman who cheats on my husband. My husband don't cheat on me. We were happy. Yes. So, but the thing is, for years I did not go to Africa. For like maybe 5 years. And that was affecting me a lot. I had not seen my family. I had not seen my mom. My whole family I had not seen. So it was like, it was disturbing me. I was being angry. My husband advised me, I know what is wrong with you. You need to go to Nigeria. You should go to Nigeria, go and spend time with your family. I was happy. I said, oh my God, finally I'm going to Nigeria. My husband said, but you'll be going alone. So just be with your family. No need to stress. You are be with the kids. He took vacation from work, from his job, 2 weeks, so I could go to Nigeria for 10 days. I went to Nigeria. I saw my family. I stayed 10 days. But inside these 10 days, 5 days already, I was calling my husband that I want to come back to Europe. That I'm not comfortable. Everywhere was too hot. The mentality, everybody, it was just like, okay, Is this what you were missing? What did you miss? Go back, please. You know that kind of stuff. It's like everybody, oh, bring, they collect. Nobody cares about you. All they want is what you brought from Europe for them. And nobody cares about you anymore. I was really disappointed, somehow. Because I thought they were missing me the way I was missing them. I didn't know they were just missing what they were not getting from me. Oh, I don't understand. So, but this is just another part of the story. But today, I went to Nigeria. I stayed 10 days and came back. That was 2 months. I went to Nigeria in May. I went 18th May and I came back 28th of May, 2013. Okay? My husband came with my kids, picked me from the airport, came back. I was happy I was back. You know, I was gisting my husband what happened in Africa, everything, you know. So, yeah? Okay, he come. Take my 5 minutes. So I, you know, told my husband everything that happened. So, but, you know, so I was like, you know, the Nigeria is too hot and everything. The mentality there has changed. I mean, it's not the same thing in you. So I don't, some things I just can't relate to, you understand? I just can't relate to. So, but the thing is, I'll come back to this video. I'm going to make it short because let me just fix something for my kids. I'll come back to part two to just talk about what happened. 2 months later, I lost my husband after I came back from Africa. When I went to Africa, let me just say this part. I went to Africa. There are widows in my family. My mother is a widow. My uncle's wives, some of them are widows. I know that my mother is a woman who allows everybody into our house. Anybody will come, whatever we give to her, she likes to share. My mother is very free-handed. So I was like, this small thing I bring for my mother now. When all these women will come, Mama will go share them with them, you know. I discovered my elder sister. So what would I give to these women? I don't want to give them money. She said, I don't give them. You know, in Africa, please don't give your money. Just buy them something. So we decided to buy 2 bags of rice, 2 bags of salt. Then 1 bag of rice and salt is for my mom. And 1 bag and salt is for this, maybe 4 of them to share it. Instead, my mother will share with them, you know. So I went to the village. I stayed as much as I could stay. I did not even stay in the village. The village said, I cannot feel sleep. I ran back to Port Harcourt because I was brought up in Port Harcourt. I ran back to Port Harcourt. Village, I only slept for 1 night. You know? Even like I said, they won't come press person, die for 9. You know that kind of thing. So me, I just ran away to the city. Went back to Port Harcourt to stay with my sisters, you know? So, but then I was missing my kids. 10 days, it was like 10 days is too long. And the way they behave, you know, just come, they switch me to stay. So all those kind of things, and then I came back to Holland, and me and my family stayed, we were fine, everything. But then I had a dream, a week before my husband died, I had this dream, and it was like I went to the village again, and I wanted to come to Holland, but there was coffin, there was no bike, there was no car, there was no transportation, okay? And then we were stranded, so I told my niece, how can I go back? I'm going to miss my flight. They said there is one bus that is coming. This dream is so clear. Paul, Johan is calling you. This dream is so clear that it still flashes my eyes up to date. So clear. So I'll come back to your comment, okay? If I just respond to the comment, I'll miss what I try to say. So what I'm trying to say is that in this dream, God showed me. If I was somebody who prayed, you know, prayed a lot and understood what the dream, but it was a terrible dream. It was a bad one. It was like I was stranded and then I was waiting for bus. There was no bus. It was like everywhere was dry, right? In the village, like Omok area, you know, in River State, Omok area. So we stood there at one junction, Akabuka Junction, me and my niece and another of my sister. They said there is one bus that's coming from Omok, that I should join the bus. But then when the bus was coming, it was like militant people. It's like all these things happening in Nigeria now. Militant people, they cover their face with masks. They carry machetes. They carry bottles. They carry things. It's like they go to kill people. And then the house where we were standing, in front of the house, behind it, is where my uncle lives. Suddenly, my uncle that lives in my village was there. I said, how come my uncle is living here? My niece told me, this is where my uncle is living now. Let us go inside because the sun was too hot and everything. Let's go inside before, you know. So when these people were coming, the breeze that when they used to say, you know, these militants, they used breeze pass, boom! I said, oh my God, my this boss had for joining. I said, nah, rush inside. Me and my niece, we ran into the place. So before we know, some guys came and they threw three heads, head of person when they don't cut, eh? Three heads, throw for that compound road with them. They be going around killing people. I was screaming, we were looking for where to hide. So, and then I was like, why are they killing people? I recognized one of the heads. I said, this is my cousin, one of my cousin. I said, this is my cousin. Why did they kill my cousin? You know, I was scared. I was really scared. So this thing I dreamt this dream after I had come back from Nigeria. Okay? Can you believe me today that my family is not even in my village anymore? Because they have chased them out. All these boys, bad boys, they carry gun, they go to your home. Like what is happening now? They read. My parents are not in the village anymore. My mother is not in the village. She's been in the city. Because they chase people now for their village. So but the thing is, and then I was crying. So why did they kill my cousin? What happened? It can't be like saying a cult problem, cultism and all that kind of stuff. Oh my God, I was so scared. I opened my eye. My husband woke me up, saying, you're screaming, you're dreaming, wake up. I woke up, I started crying. You see what happened? I said, see what happened? I saw myself in the village. This is what happened. I could not come back to Holland, but they kill people. They put three heads there. So one of the heads is my cousin. I said, oh my God, let it not be like my elder brother is in problem, you know? But I recognized that my cousin's face, Uba. I said, why did they kill Uba? Why did they kill him? I told my parents this dream. I called home. I told my brother told me, yeah, he has some problem with one of my cousin, and that my cousin is in cult, and blah, blah, blah. They are going around killing people. I said, for real? He said, yes. I said, this is the dream I had. This dream kept flashing. I went to the beach with my husband. We were sitting at the beach. The dream came in. They do me like saying a craze. My husband said, what is it? You have to call your brother. I called my brother. I said, send your brother money to leave the village. I was supposed to send my brother money on the 15th, which is on Monday, 15th of July, 2013. I was supposed to send my brother Western Union to leave village. My husband died on the Sunday, a day before I could send my brother money. I did not know. Even I was praying with my husband, I said, hey, this dream keep coming. I would tell my husband, get up, let us pray. You know, you go now, you don't know, you know to believe in prayer, they're on a Catholic, you know to, yeah, you know say God, they, but you know be that type where they prepare, go just doing thing, and it's okay. I'm like, you have to say amen, I want pray African way, they cast and bind. But since he was not really respond, I just did my thing, and you know, but the dream kept flashing to me. My brother was supposed to leave the village, only for me to call my brother again, to tell my family that my husband just died. Can you believe it? Eh? And again, in my mother's village, one of my uncle was also assassinated. Another place they assassinated, this was the three heads that I saw. One was my husband, my uncle, and another person. Yes. So, there is power in prayer. And when God show you something, some dreams, they say, oh, it's mere dream. You have to pray. You have to be prayerful. My husband was sitting and we were talking about the dream. My husband was even making jokes, sitting in my garden, telling me that this my dream reminds him. Say the way they do say, reminds him that one when they were young, some days they went to the city, in their city here in Dihe. They went to drink. It was late. They were coming back. He had to go back to his, then he was still living with his parents. He hadn't married. He had to go back. So they were going through the bush. But then one of his friends made a joke that what if somebody come out of this bush and just cut their head off? You know, so that they made a joke out of it, but it was scary. So this is my dream that it is really scary. My uncle called me, Douglas, to say, hey, I should send money. They have assassinated one of my uncle. I should send money for burial. My mother has to contribute money for burial. The same day, this my uncle talked to us on Saturday with my husband. My husband died on Sunday. I was devastated. It was afternoon like this. Eh? Man that was not sick. We were good. Everything was okay. We went to the beach that weekend. We came back. He hasn't gone to hospital to say this one and one kind sickness. I've been come back from Nigeria 2 months before it happened, but people carry gist that I just come back from Nigeria. I sleep with my husband. That you see Nigerian people, you see African people. I said, the God of the widows, when he start to punish all of you that are accusing me of what I did not know, when he start to punish them, they will be asking God, say, what can I do for this life? They don't know what they are doing. They don't know that they are playing with the apple of God's eyes. The man died a peaceful death. You people leave me alone. It was his time to go. He has traveled around the world, even as young as he was. He has traveled around the world. The one thing that was disturbing him in life was that he didn't have kids. But then he got kids. He was satisfied. So in this life, nobody chooses to be a widow. People can choose to be divorced, but nobody chooses to be a widow. If you choose to be a widow, then you are a witch. Then you are evil. Because I'm not going to kill you. Kill, for what now? Kill and waiting. What is my joy then? What is my gain? To be lonely and miserable? Eh? So, like I do this talk show, I said it is my therapy. I have a lot to talk about, a lot of experience, okay? From when I was married to when I started being a widow. How people change, how things change. In a twinkle of an eye, your whole life can change. But it takes somebody with God fearing to stand and come out and still smile. When my husband died, I was a comedian. I was standing on stage and entertaining people. My husband was my number one fan. AFTV channel, The Hague. The only female comedian. They knew me as a comedian, not as a talk show host. But this death made me to be coming and talking to people, go on the street and interview people. It made me discover another part. My brother-in-law's advice me, say, go back to your comedy. You can't leave. That is, your husband was your number one fan. He was taking you to all these events. Since my husband died, it's difficult for me to attend events. It just be like, say, oh, now for his studio, they do things. They don't understand. So I don't need all these divorces, all these ladies who choose to be wayward and their husbands divorce them, or they want to divorce and be wayward, to come and stand in my front and talk to me because they don't have dignity. If they were in my shoes, they would have married one black man by now. They would have put one black man in the house. I am not that type. And if they don't marry black, they for don't marry another white. But I am not that type. I have respect for my children. I have two men to raise, two boys to raise, to be responsible men. I'm not going to be wayward. I'm not going to put my life in danger. And I'm not going to sleep with any man just because I want to be famous. I have respect for my husband. I still bear his name. I am not ugly. I have men who are asking my hand. Responsible people who want to marry me. I don't want. I have my children. I don't want my attention to be divided. Until my children are man enough to stand and say, Mama, you know what? Even now they feel sorry for me. They say, Mama, you're too lonely. This is bad. My sons, they talk to me. They console me. Me coming here and talking to people and putting a smile on people's face, educating people, inspiring people. I don't think there's so many of us that can do that after you lost a husband in just interval of 3 years. I opened my own business to make sure that I occupy myself, not going to parties, not drinking, not doing other kind of shit. They expect to see me in every party. They expect to see me in every occasion, but I am not like that. I have self-worth, and I know who I am, and I know where I am coming from. And there's nothing anybody can rant or say about me on social media that will change the fact that God has blessed me, and I have no reason. I have no reason whatsoever to complain. If I didn't have kids, maybe I was not here, then I have gone back to Africa to what they are wishing me. Even some families are expecting that after my husband died, I should return to Africa. So do what with you people? I am legally married. I am a national. Okay, I am a national. I can choose to go everywhere, anywhere I want to go. But I am not returning to my father's house. For what? My policy, once married, always married. From a widow, I will be somebody's wife, not somebody's girlfriend. I am not a girlfriend material. So I don't need anybody to come here and call me baby or use the opportunity that you know now that I am a widow, you want to insult yourself. I will disgrace you because I am a critic. So everybody, watch your space. Watch this space very, very well. With all due respect, watch this space because I am still a married woman and I am still wearing my marriage ring. So thank you very much for listening. I have to attend to my kids. When I'm done with my kids, I will come back to tell you more stories about life and death. Thanks for joining. I'll reply to your comments later. But everybody stay strong. To all widows out there, stay strong and take care of your children until God, the God of the widows, he's the father of the fatherless and the husband of the widows. Read Jeremiah 29. His plans for me are not of evil, but of good. Before my husband died, God knew he was going to die. God knew the day he was born, and God knew the day he was going to die. God already knew what was going to happen. Before he died physically, he had died spiritually. But I did not see it. We did not see it. So people, shut your mouth and stop writing rubbish about me and asking me what happened to your husband. Things that this is nonsense. People tell me they go to school 11 years. You went to school, but you're sitting there on your wall and asking me what killed my husband. You are a shallow person because the divorce that you have gone through is disturbing you. You're happy my husband died, so I will join you as a single woman. But sorry, I am bearing my husband's name. I am in my husband's house with my husband's children. And it's only a widow that knows where the father of her children is, not divorcees. So people should shut up and give me some respect. because it's not easy. Thanks for listening. I'll be with you next time. Soon. I love you all, my fans. Thanks, everything. Thank you very much. Thanks for your support. Thanks for sharing my videos. It's just an emotional day for me, and I am reading all this nonsense online, and even the ones they are saying and I'm hearing, but it's not a problem for me, because it goes to show that it is better you did not even go to school and behave normal than to go to school and then come and act something that people would do, and you tell them, why are you doing this? And then you tell me you are educated. As if people don't die. You yourself who's talking, you don't know tomorrow, you don't know your destiny, you don't know shit. You don't even know what's going to happen. You don't know about your children. You don't know about your soul. Just shut your mouth and stop insulting widows. And stop molesting widows or trying to abuse widows. They did not choose for that life. Okay? I went to the village. I fed widows. I came back from village. I became a widow. I was asking, say, God, oh, what you make me go give widows food? Oh, I don't go give widows food. I don't turn to widow. Now, waiting at the cry for my house. Now, waiting at the cry. Even my uncle wife talk and say, hey, you wake up Nigeria, can't give us food, finish. You can't go back. Your husband can't die. I just smile. I cut the phone. So leave Africa. Leave people. 5 years, I don't go Nigeria. I go Nigeria, come back 2 months, my husband die. I'm not talking that Nigerian people kill him. I don't talk so. But I only say maybe certain things. I for not give those widows then the food. But people, church people, all those things, they tell me, say, na lie. You say, that one when I do, say, na because God don't see, say, I go be widow. Now he make me go give those widows food. Say, as a widow, me, I no go lack. And it is well with me and my children. I shall not as a widow. My children shall not lack. Because I fed widows before I became a widow. May God bless everybody.